Yes, back to me. Then we can actually jump to the presentation part. You can jump to the next slide where we will see our speaker today, which is Dr. Morten Goodwin. And we're lucky to have him with us to share from his long experience within artificial intelligence. And as you can see, Morten has several hats to wear. He's a professor at the University of Agder. He's a coordinator of the International Master's Program in ICT, and also the Deputy Director of Center of Artificial Intelligence Research. And also he is a public speaker, a public debater, and a writer. And he also wrote a book, I think it was last year, on artificial intelligence. So you can see that he's the right person to let us know some tips and tricks when creating value from artificial intelligence. So the Zoom floor is yours, Morten.
Great. Thank you, Alice. Also, I'm professor at Oslo Met, which I have some connection to Oslo in there. Great introduction, and I'm so glad that you want to listen to me talk about artificial intelligence. Today's talk will be in the level of inspiration, so inspirational talk is the idea. Hopefully you all see my screen now. The aim is to all give you a powerful message to tell you the secret of making powerful artificial intelligence in Norway. It's not a very big secret because I say it every so often, but I will try to let you in on the secret a little down the presentation. The key, you all know artificial intelligence, and you all know how artificial intelligence is presented in the media. You all know how artificial intelligence is talked about, and many of you know that artificial intelligence, the way we academics or the way we people that work with artificial intelligence or machine learning daily is very different from how artificial intelligence is spoken about when it's presented out broad. And that is part of why I wrote my book also, Myten om maskinene. If you're interested, that's available. But just one key example that gives you the impression of what the real world out there thinks about artificial intelligence is something that happened to me right before COVID hit. And I understand after COVID, you will have a big part of it, even two slices of pizza. Let's hope I can be invited for that. But right before COVID, I was asked to join a Norwegian TV show called Dagsrevyen. So if you're Norwegian, you know Dagsrevyen. Every old person in Norway watches Dagsrevyen. It is a national news show that happens every time at 6 o'clock or 8 o'clock. So we were supposed to talk about chatbots, robots that talk, and specifically some a specific type of chatbot called griefbot. Griefbot is a robot that is trained like a machine learning approach, but it is trained with people who have passed away. Meaning, if my wife dies, God forbid, I can train a chatbot to mimic her and have a kind of artificial version of my wife if I wanted to, God forbid. Of course, there's ethical problems with this. It's also far-fetched. There was a TV show talking about this, Black Mirror, maybe some have seen it. But it is actually a tool that is sold in our neighboring country, Sweden. If you go to an agency there, you can buy a coffin, you can buy a picture of your wife after she passes. And you can also buy this type of chatbot trained with it. So our idea was that we can talk about this. We can talk about the bad things about this, possibilities. But instead of only talking broadly about what artificial intelligence can and cannot do, we decided let's demonstrate how this works. So what we did, we got access to Luis, the journalist, Facebook account, and we downloaded every content she's given to Facebook. According to the law, GDPR, you can now do that. You can go to Facebook and download everything you have given away. And we trained a robot to mimic Luis in a way. Of course, we put it into a real physical robot because that's very cool for Dagsrevyen people, not just an iPad type of system, but it kind of looks a bit more when it has legs and arms and eyes, these things, right? So that's what we did. We put like a relatively simple artificial intelligence learned from Luis conversations on Facebook. And we recorded live on tape with her interviewing the robot. So of course she did not pass away, she did not die, but she interviewed herself as if she had died. So for example, she asked about, do you love me? To the robot. So typically something you would ask a robot, do you love me? And the robot says, yes, love you too, mommy. Well, very good. And then she asked in Norwegian, what are you going to do this weekend? Milfred, that's the name of the robot. And Milfred answered, we're going to party. Using the Norwegian swear word, for fun. So that's very bad in Norwegian to say this. And after this interview on Dagsrevyen, my mother called me and said, so now I told all my friends, you should come and watch your son on Dagsrevyen, and you make a robot that swears. So all my friends are watching very, very bad. And of course, many of you probably know why this happened. The reason is, of course, that the AI, I didn't program it, it was trained, and it was Louise who has been swearing on Facebook. But of course, when Louise has been on Facebook, she's most of the time not been a serious NRK journalist, TV journalist. She's been a teenager wanting to talk about party, wanting to swear to her friends and these type of things. And of course, you know that the idea of artificial intelligence is exactly this. Most of my learning is training from data, learning from complex data processes, such as a conversation on Facebook. And that is very different than what most people talk about artificial intelligence outside of the group. So why should we care? Why should Norway care about that type of system? So you can make a robot that talks on Dagsrevyen, but yeah, who really cares, right? And we get this type of artificial neurons that many have seen before that are kind of mimicking biological neurons that exists in some of us, and we like to draw them in mathematical way, we like to program them, and we get these type of extreme cases where we have artificial intelligence really, really working well. There's many examples, and I'm sure many of you have heard of many of them as well, about artificial intelligence doing very well. My favorite example is one on a disease called diabetic retinopathy. It's a disease for the eye. It is shown with a couple of years ago. It was a competition, a Kaggle type of competition, competition online, talking about artificial intelligence in an amazing way, learning from the eyes, people with this disease and learning without this disease and picking up trends from it. And not surprisingly, it did very well. Not surprising to people who have read artificial intelligence academic papers, it did better than medical doctors. It's very often the case that it does. Of course, that's only part of the story. It does well, but it typically does has mistakes that the medical doctor does not have, and the medical doctor has mistakes that the AI does have. That's not what I'm putting this example about. So this was a research example 5 or 6 years ago, driven by a person that is very well known in the AI world, Jeffrey Hinton, one of the pioneers in AI. But what was an academic game computed like a couple of years ago was last year put into rural India as real application software. So in India, one of the many places that suffers from huge quantities of diabetics, and then also huge quantities of exactly this disease. We have, on average, rural parts of India, 11 doctors per million. Here is where an AI system really, really makes a powerful impact. Why am I saying this? Because used to be very separate, the academic world and the industry or public sector, is merging more and more. What I see as an academic world is not really the same as it was 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. What we see as research now becomes application areas just few years later. So the distance between theoretical academic work and real practical application that really matters out there is so short, shorter than any time been before. And that is an amazing way to live an academic life, seeing that it actually has a huge impact. And then, how is this possible? How can we understand this kind of application area? There are, in my opinion, three ways to think of it. So of course, whenever you see slides that says three easy ways to solve this, three ways to do this, five ways to solve something, is always a bit, you should always be skeptical, right? Because there's always a bit more complicated. So except for now, now it is really true. So there's three ways to think to make really, really powerful AI, in my opinion. One is to have a problem that is very concrete and measurable. It can be that you classify images of the deceased doctor into diseased eyes, into not diseased eyes, or it can be music that plays well, music that plays badly. It can be playing a chess game that wins or loses. So something that is very measurable, right? And not surprisingly to most of you, you need to have data and you need to seek the power of your data. So meaning that you need a lot of data, more the better generally, but that's not all of it, but you need data that actually fits the system that you want to play with. So you can get a lot of data that is irrelevant, doesn't maybe even noise to the AI, but it can be data that has some sort of impact to you, is really, really relevant. Second rule. Third rule, in my opinion, is the most important rule, and that is to understand the problem and the process. We see time and time again, at least in academic world, that people are just trying to pour a little AI on a problem and without really, really understanding what is happening out there. So for example, my work with medical doctors, I'm very humble and I say to the medical doctors, so this is your knowledge, you have to teach me how this really works. And when I work with fashion, that's a field I work with, very surprising to younger, I would be very surprised to my younger self that I actually have to work with this area because I don't care about that at all. But so there's some fashion experts there out. They understand the problem. So I work with agriculture. There's some agriculture experts. I work with fish. There's some fish experts. And in all of those cases, they have very, very immense domain knowledge that I can apply our machine learning algorithms on. And then we get data, of course, and then we have some sort of thing that is measurable. You have something that it needs to measure, you need data, and you need to understand the problem, in my humble opinion. And if you look at the huge tech giants, this is exactly what they do, right? Uber, Facebook, Instagram, name whatever you want. They have something that is measurable. They understand their audience. That's why they have a huge impact. And they, of course, they collect data. There's many examples where people don't understand the examples that they work with. They don't understand the problem. This is one case such. It is from 2 Minute Papers. If you're not familiar with this YouTube channel, you should. It's a very good one. So, and this is on cat classifications. And in this case, there's some famous neural networks, machine learning techniques, AlexNet, GoogleNet, etc., and they categorize cats with an accuracy of 100% or 100%. And there's some humans. Humans get an accuracy of 99%. But I'm not sure about the last percentage here, don't really understand, but like most people will get that this is a cat. So AI is better. But when we make the picture grayscale, it becomes a little bit more challenging for the AI and a little bit more challenging for the human. When we add a silhouette of the cat, humans are able to understand the problem well and categorize it as a cat. The rest AI systems are failing dramatically. And when you put edges around the cat, it happens even more. So why does this happen? Well, we know this as the framing problem. AI cannot really learn outside of what it's been trained for. So when you train an AI for these type of cats, categorizing these type of cats that don't exist in real life, is very, very challenging, if not impossible. For us humans, this is a very, very simple task. We, even though we've never seen this type of cat, it is really, we can still somehow, at least 87% of us tell that it is a real cat. This is something called the AI readiness level driven by United Nations. It is close to the government readiness index. If some of you know it, it tells how good is a certain country in prospering AI. It has to do with digitalization. It has to do with how to fuel startups. And for example, Oslo AI would then be one that fuels this in a certain way. So Norway is high up there, but not the highest. So we're very digital, but we are not as good as United States in fueling startups, for example. So that is why we're not at the top level there. But our possibilities is absolutely there. Norway is one of the most digital countries, you know. AI is very prosperous there. So we now talked about that you need data. It can fail when you look at data. Let's look at some examples of that. I'll draw from my own experience because I can make a fool of myself before I make a fool of others. It's better. So one of the areas that we work with is in nutrition. So some person want to eat healthy, and we talk to the nutritionists, and they say, not surprising if you ever watched some of the reality shows out there, that people struggle with losing weight, for example. Known challenge, right? And people can follow a diet a couple of days, but as most diets, they fail after a couple of weeks. Something happens. It's famously after the New Year's resolution, right? Sometime in January, you fail. But so can AI help? So yes, of course, AI can help. So what did we do? Well, we made a neural network machine learning system to take picture of food. And the idea was that we can accurately detect what is there. So this is cheese, this is bread, you name it. Of course, AI can do that, no problem. And then we tried, can we do more object detection, semantic segmentation, and connect it directly to the amount of cheese, the amount of butter, these type of things. And my students came to me and told me, so yes, we can do it. We have now with 100% accuracy or near percent accuracy detection of butter and cheese there. We can even tell that it is 4.4 grams of butter, 6.4 grams of cheese. And I think, oh, that's good. It's very good. So how in the world can you really tell that it is 4.4 grams of butter under this cheese? It seems very hard to do. So what we realize is that the AI system has had learned very well. It has, in fact, done what's called overfitting. And it has not learned anything from the right side of the image here about the plate and the food and all of those things. It didn't care about that. It only cared about the post-it note on the left side here. The post-it note on the left side tells that it is butter, smør in Norwegian, 4.4 gram, cheese, 6.4 grams. So then it kind of overfitted only on this post-it note. And then we realized, let's just remove it. Easy technique. It became much, much, much more challenging. So it kind of, we didn't really understand the data. We didn't really understand the application area because the nutritionists thought they had been very nice. So it's in addition to putting information into the Excel spreadsheet, they had added information as post-it notes. Of course, this came to the problem for us because we didn't understand it. So we didn't follow the three main rules. This has had much more serious implications also. Famous examples where you want to detect, this is not from our research, but from someone else, detect skin cancer. The idea, of course, you have a lot of examples of skin cancer, not a lot of examples of moles, which are not skin cancer. Can we detect the difference? Of course, the answer is yes. But the data was very skewed. In this case, some people had a ruler next to the mole. And that was more frequent when it was a skin cancer case. So what did the AI pick up? You want the presence of a ruler on your skin. So whether or not I put a ruler on my skin, of course, has no impact on whether or not I'm sick. The AI doesn't care, right? It feels it's a very, very overfitted type of system. You all know this advertisement is often AI-based. This tragic case, AI, the system tells skydiver has died after severed legs. And what does the AI suggest as advertisement? Well, let's make an advertisement for an airplane company. So if I ever wanted to fly, it's less now. It's not a place, time to put an advertisement for exactly this. Very, very wrong. Keyword wise, it makes sense. Perfect. But this advertisement, not so good. Let's look at one more example there. This is from, I believe, Germany. They wanted to make an AI-based system to detect soccer balls. There's a lot of small teams playing, one village playing against the next village, works very well. They don't have people to do camera crew to go and visit all the time. So let's make an AI that follows the ball perfectly. Should work perfectly. And it did work for quite some time until one day a bald line judge, I'm sure it's called in Norwegian, joined up. So the AI could not tell the difference between the man without hair on the right side and the ball. So in this case, it was following the ball completely. They did not really understand the problem. They did not really, they had enough data. They had something that was measurable, but it was struggling. Last case example of this. You all know the country China. They use AI to do surveillance and a lot of other bad things. This is a Chinese celebrity. She suddenly detected a lot of jaywalking fines. She got a lot of fines at home. She walked on the street when she was not supposed to, and she was very surprised. So why is this happening? I didn't walk there. So why problematic? Well, it turns out the AI system detected buses, and on the side of the bus was the picture of herself. Whenever the bus was riding around in Beijing or one of those big cities, she got a fine because it automatically detected her presence. So the Chinese government didn't think people are not only people, but sometimes there's pictures of people on buses. They didn't really understand it. So if we can find this type of thing, it's of course truly amazing to solve it. One of the key innovations, not bad examples, but good examples, we have too little data in many, many cases. Often we have too little data of high enough quality, or we have too little data of that is not labeled incorrectly. So you may have a lot of pictures of cars on the internet, or a lot of pictures of MRI scans from brains, but you don't have the capacity to tell which car it is, or don't have the capacity to ask a medical doctor to do annotation of it. One of the most exciting directions of research, which I'm sure will have a huge application domain outside of the academic world also, is something called semi-supervised learning and the closely related self-supervised learning. Self-supervised learning is, among other, that you take a picture, you make some sort of task, auxiliary task, puzzle, let's say. In this case, you take a car and you make a puzzle out of it, and the task is for the AI to puzzle it back together as kind of a pre-training, training before training really happens. And it turns out that when you train on these type of techniques, you don't need to label the car, you just have to have pictures of cars, and then you don't need to make sure, and then you can learn the weights from the neural network, you can learn what is happening there, and then use it on, let's say, one very small data set, for actually detecting the presence of cars, or presence of disease in these type of things. So what used to be a real need for huge data sets labeled, of course, it's still there, but there's a lot of research in the area of trying to make this more useful for you. And examples of this is put in the prostate cancer research, brain cancer research, and many, many other places. And this is closely related to techniques that you all or many of you are familiar with, what's called generative techniques, closely related to what deepfake is doing. It's a kind of boiling soup on the same data over and over again and learning features from it that is most relevant. There's also this understanding of the data and unexplainable techniques, and that is kind of mythically out there. So of course many of the big neural networks are very hard to interpret and hard to explain. They can make decisions and you cannot really follow it properly. That's true, of course, but I would say this is this is exaggerated quite a bit. So of course there's things that we don't understand in these big neural networks, but there's certainly things that we do understand also. So this is one example. Titanic, you all know Titanic. It was a ship that went down 100 years ago. This is a neural network trained to predict whether or not you will survive from the tiny robot. It does so very well, no big problem. And then we ran, or then this is not us, but someone else ran what's called SHAP analysis, some statistical analysis, and asked which features are most relevant for the predictions that we do now. So what really influences the system to say that you should survive from Titanic and you should die from Titanic? It was gender as the highest relevance point, class as the second highest, age as the third highest. So for example, if you were male, so it's a little bit spoiler for Titanic if you haven't seen Titanic, just in case. So if you're male, Leonardo DiCaprio, you will die from Titanic, so already there. And if you're female and you're first class, you will survive. So this other person, Rose or whatever she, her name was, will survive. So the entire Titanic movie is in this there. So you can watch everyone here and see like, oh, this one survives, this one dies. So we can really explain how this neural network, deep learning, that is considered by many a black box, how the, it really influences each other. But more relevant, this is for an AI that detects the presence of Alzheimer in a person. So what is the most influences? Cognitive dissonance, cognitive problems is most relevant. You have some sort of cognitive problem. Age is the second most relevant, of course. People with Alzheimer tend to be old. And family relations is the fourth one. And many claim that hours of sleep is very relevant for Alzheimer, not according to the AI system. You can do the same for predicting COVID. Everybody does some COVID research now. So we used some open data from US to predict where will the next COVID outbreak be. Of course, the neural network did well on this. What are the most influenced technique? What were the features? I mean, total number of deaths are the highest relevant there. Why am I saying this? Of course, you have the data, you have the model. You may be in a black box type of way, but it may also be explainable with these type of statistical techniques. So what many claim is a black box way is not as black box as many claim, I would say. So I would end with what happened to me before Christmas 2019, right before COVID. I was asked to host the Christmas party at our university. And the responsibility for the Christmas party person is to bring cookies. And I said, sure, I can bring cookies, but I want to do it specially. So what did I do? I went to internet and I found all cookie recipes, Christmas cookie recipes. And I trained an AI to make new cookies for me. So of course, a little bit trickery there. But after the, and then we, after generation, epoch 17, generation 17. So this is in Norwegian, but I'll explain. It had only, made only a cookie that had the recipe vanilla sugar. So it looks like this, very bad cookie. So we trained it longer. After 400 generations, it had 750 grams of fruits. It had to be cooked in about 1 hour. It's a very long time to cook Christmas cookies. I'm not sure how familiar you are, but that's very long. Normally it's like 10 minutes, but 1 hour for some reason. It looked like this. So it was a lot of fat, a lot of sugar, and it tasted Christmassy, but you know, maybe not perfect yet. After generation 800, it makes much more sense. You cook for 10 minutes. And what we realized is this is kind of like an omelet that you cook for a long time, and then you put some frosting on top of it. Tasted very well, but it's not the most perfect cookie out there. A lot of fat, a lot of sugar again. After 900 generation, we saw that it couldn't learn anything more. Now it becomes a little bit more tasty. A lot of cinnamon and a lot of spice. Cream cheese, maybe to balance it out. Maybe it's a bit random, but it looked like this. And of course, I've served it to the university Christmas party. And if you invite me in for the two slice pizza, I can also bring some Christmas cookies from AI also there. We did the same in Blå in Oslo with drinks. And Moddy did a Christmas song from this type of there. And in Sørlandet, this is my last slide. In Sørlandet, you may know that this is a very religious place. So a journalist asked me if you can make cookies, if you can make songs, maybe you can make sermons as well. And we did. So we went to NRK and we get all the sermons that is put online. And we made then my robot. Of course, put it in a robot face. It looks more cool for the TV people. And we asked him, do we have a new sermon? And this is translated from English because it was Norwegian. But this is the sermon that was given in the most religious place in Norway. Good morning. Generosity is about having faith and lighting candles. I asked in a holy room. My heart wanders in anticipation and my heart must be joy. And Jesus, Jesus, at this table sit the angels of your time and say this. He found the poor and foolish to be near. God was ignited by his sorrow and waited. You are worth loving. Not every person in Agder, in Sørlandet, thought this was a good use of university time and university money. Some talked about losing contact with what was the real purpose of Sørlandet and real bad. But the point I'm making is that this, of course, we didn't really understand the data properly. It was more a gimmick time. A priest had to come in later to get it properly. But at least we had data. We had some sort of way to measure it. Maybe he didn't understand the problem well enough, but at least we made fun doing it. Thank you. So this was the idea of my question. Or we will then have Alice, please, yeah. What will we do next?
Great, Morten, that was perfect. I love the last examples. I would love to see how these models were trained to put this perfectly nice ceremony. So thank you for your presentation. And I would love, of course, to start to tell more about what I think about all of these topics and your presentation, but I think we will instead go into breakout rooms where we can everyone discuss the presentation and topics and more topics of AI in groups. So I'll just divide into breakout rooms and then we will meet up for a wrap up in half an hour time. And then we can also discuss it a little bit more. So I'll see if I can manage to do these breakout rooms now. Even you can ask any questions if you have any in the meantime.
I actually have a question regarding the slides with the cats. So there were 5 pictures that you explained quite nicely. But I think the last one, maybe I didn't get the explanation, but could you just explain one more time, like the data, how the distribution is there? So how well can humans recognize the cats compared to different neural networks?
Sure. I won't share my slides again. So the neural networks it is a blind study. So I didn't do this study, but it's a famous one about different cats and the accuracy of not cats, but different types of animal and the accuracy for the neural networks on the different models. So meaning that there's a lot of animals, I'm not sure, maybe it's the CIFAR data set categorizing cats and made some changes to it. And the neural network will then in 100% of the cases categorize cats correctly. Cat correctly here. Of course, it will do the same with dog, animal, plane. I don't know what's really in this data set, but it's there. So the last image is, maybe you can guess what it is. And if not, I will tell you, and it is elephant. And in this case, the AI is able to do it perfectly. Key is that many humans have a hard time detecting that it's an elephant because it's not the entire elephant, you just see a little bit of small prick or small part of the elephant. But the neural network is still picking up the pattern from the elephant very well. That is the idea. So it's I suggest that you go into 2 minutes paper and search for this example where it's explained in much, much more detail what really happened there. But it's a comparison between human persons and neural networks on image classification.
So maybe I got fooled with this one, because previously these were now four cats, and then I thought it would be another picture of a cat, but I just couldn't figure out how this picture then relates to a cat.
Yeah. You overfit it. Yes, you don't. Yeah. You think four cats, then next moment it's the cat, but in this case it's elephant. Yes, that's true.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for the questions. I will open the breakout rooms now, so I'll see you guys in around half an hour. Good luck.